But thou, O Lord, have mercy on us.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We see millions of citizens fleeing from their war-torn country. We watch tens of millions of babies being murdered by abortion since Roe v. Wade passed in the 1970s. We experience families torn apart by addiction. And we hear the devastating news that a loved one has incurable cancer. This is what we see in the world. We turn on the news only to be confronted yet again by the evil that is in the world. We see the effect that sin has on the world, and quite honestly, we can be left confused when we come to our readings for tonight. We just heard in our epistle reading, now in putting everything in subjection to him, he left nothing outside his control. And then we heard in our gospel reading, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Now for these past few weeks, we have heard about Jesus as the prophet and the priest. But now how are we to understand him for tonight as king in the kingdom of grace? Yes, we do see him as the prophet and the priest, as they have talked about previously. But how is he the king in the kingdom of grace? But before we can unpack his role as the king in this kingdom, we first have to discuss what this kingdom is all about. Over the next 2 weeks, we're going to be talking about two different kingdoms, the kingdom of grace and the kingdom of glory. Next week, we'll learn about the kingdom of glory, but for this week, we're focusing on the kingdom of grace. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we are in the kingdom of grace right now. It is the church here on earth of which we are a part of. In our baptism, by the means of grace, we are made members of this kingdom. Jesus is the king of this kingdom, and we read in our epistle that everything is in subjection to him. Now, while it is certainly true that everything is under his control, how are we supposed to understand his role as king in the kingdom when we see the world around us? After all, wouldn't we expect everything to just be smooth sailing? Wouldn't we want him to rule with a mighty arm and take away all of our troubles? Wouldn't we want him to be wearing this type of crown? We aren't the only ones expecting this type of king. The Jews during the time of Jesus were expecting a Messiah who would make your enemies a footstool for your feet, as Psalm 110 says. They expected a Messiah to come and rule as a king on earth in the likeness of David, one who would wear that earthly crown. But what did they see instead? While they did see the Messiah come, the Son of God taking on human flesh, the Messiah was not born to rule in an earthly palace like they expected. Instead, he was born in a manger in a no-name town. He did not triumphantly ride into Jerusalem on some white horse and defeat all the Romans. No, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey in order to be crucified. He did not receive a jeweled crown. Instead, he received a crown of thorns. This was their long-expected Messiah. And many didn't recognize him. They expected a Messiah who would exercise his power here on earth. But Christ didn't come and exercise the power here in the way that they wanted. Instead, our epistle reads, but we see him who, for a little while, was made lower than the angels, namely Jesus. He took on human flesh, took our sins upon himself and suffered the price for our sins. As the prophet Isaiah foretold, he wrote, "His appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind. He was beaten, mocked, and nailed to the cross. He died and he rose on the third day." Luther writes in the explanation of the second article of the Apostles' Creed that Jesus purchased and won me from all sins, from death, and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own and live under him in his kingdom. He tasted death for everyone by his crucifixion and then his resurrection, in order that all who believed would have eternal life in the kingdom of glory, which is to come. So when these bad things do happen, which we know all too well that they do happen, it can sometimes be hard to understand our epistle for tonight and to remember that he is in fact the king of this kingdom of grace. Now, I'm not going to be diving into why bad things still happen. That can be saved for another sermon or a Bible class. But it would appear that we aren't alone in struggling with understanding Jesus' kingship. The author of Hebrews seems to have anticipated such struggling, and so he writes, "At present, we do not yet see everything in subjection to him." That little phrase, "at present," is speaking of our life here on earth, meaning that in this life, we do not always see how it's possible that God is in control, but yet we are reminded time and time again that everything is in subjection to him. We do not always see why these things happen, but we do see our Savior, Jesus, the King of the kingdom of grace. As King, he still guards and protects his kingdom here on earth. Paul writes in 2 Thessalonians 3, "But the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one." And so it's in response to this that here in a few minutes we will sing these words: "Preserve in wave and tempest thy storm-tossed little flock. Assailed by wind and weather, may it endure each shock. Take thou the helm, O pilot, and set the course aright. Thus we shall reach the harbor in thine eternal light." Christ reigns victorious over the kingdom here on earth, and we eagerly await the day where he will come again, and where we will live with him in his kingdom of glory forever and ever. Amen. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.